is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. Very excited to have a returning guest on the Thriving Dentist Show, Dr. Lou Kaufman. Hey, Lou, how are you?
I'm doing great, Gary. How are you?
Oh, man. I missed not seeing you a couple weeks ago in Chicago.
Yeah, you got hit by that major snowstorm and high winds.
Just for our listeners' benefit, I was headed to go to the Chicago midwinter meeting on Wednesday, and I had a 7 a.m. flight and got to the airport early. And sure enough, Chicago was experiencing a heavy snowstorm, but I think it was the wind more than anything. Chicago can handle snow.
But yeah, the wind was nuts.
Yeah, the wind was crazy. I think it was gusting to 60 miles an hour. Anyway, my flight was canceled, and they were all the flights that day into Chicago were canceled. However, they got me on a 7 p.m. flight, and the anticipation was that weather would lift and I'd be able to get out at night. Turns out that flight was canceled again because of the weather. The soonest they could get me out was the next day, and because of the time change, I wouldn't have gotten in till Thursday evening. And by then, I would have missed about 75% of what I was going there for. So, unfortunately, I miss seeing Lou.
I miss seeing you too, Gary. I always look forward to it. Well, it's always fun.
Well, and the reason I invited Lou back on the show is because the first interview we did went viral. How
awesome.
Cool is that?
That is really cool.
So, hey, I'm going to put that first. And we always pick up new listeners. In fact, we have a new listeners from Cuba. The most recent country we added to our listener list are a handful of dentists in the country of Cuba. How cool is that?
Can't wait to go. It's on the bucket list.
It is totally awesome. On my bucket list. It is completely on my. So if you're listening to this from Cuba, you will not have to ask me twice to come visit. I can't wait to get to Cuba myself. But we have new listeners all the time. Lou, I'm going to go ahead and put a link to the first interview that we did in the show notes. So if any of you have not heard that first interview, I want to invite you to go to the show notes. You can find those at Takas, T-A-K-A-C-S, learningcenter.com. And I'll put a link to that first interview, and I invite you to listen to that. Lou talked about all kinds of cool things about how to build your practice in that interview. It went viral. And because of that, I wanted to have you come on back. And today, we're going to talk about some cool things you're doing to set up a fantastic year in 2016. Does that sound like a good way to sort of characterize the different things we're going to talk about?
I sound right on track with that. Yes, I love it.
Hey, for the benefit of listeners that may be meeting you for the first time on this podcast, Lou, could you give us a little bit of a Reader's Digest condensed version of your background so your listeners can understand a bit about your journey?
My journey in dentistry began, I graduated dental school in 95. I'll be 21 years this June. But before that, I was in the restaurant industry, and I worked for Pillsbury Corporation, and I had an MBA, and I was a troubleshooting restaurant specialist, and literally went into restaurants that were having trouble and turned them around, sometimes replacing the entire team. And then this is, and we didn't talk about this last time. I actually got accused of the money was missing. And I was brought in for a lie detector test. And at that point, I said, you know what? I am done with corporate America. I called up my boss right afterwards, and I said, the keys are on the desk. I'm out of here. I'm done. And I always had a thought that I might want to go into medicine or dentistry. And I just, I gave up social life. I went back to school. I was attending community college with a bunch of kids much younger than myself. And for 1 year, I took all the sciences you needed for dental school, and then I applied to dental school and went to dental school. And I wouldn't change anything. I would, I'd do it all over again if I had to. I love this profession.
Now, at what age did you graduate dental school, Lou?
I was 32.
So you're a little bit older than the typical graduate because of your career path, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Interesting.
And then I had some other classmates that were also, like same age group. One guy was 50 in our class.
Hey.
And, you know, I looked him up recently and he's doing great.
Very cool. You know, I teach on Mondays at Midwestern School of Dental Medicine here in Glendale, Arizona. And I have a first year class where my oldest student in the first year class is 46.
Oh, that's awesome.
I think it's kind of cool. Now, you have some family history, though. You had some footsteps to fill.
I did. My father was a practicing dentist. And what's really cool is I didn't tell him I was going to do any of this. I went and talked to people I knew from him about the profession of dentistry and, you know, the path. And then when I decided to apply to dental school is when I actually told him, you know, hey, this is what I'm going to do. And he was really excited. And I went into a practice. We got to practice together for 15 years. My dad retired about 6 years ago, and he took it from a one operatory practice to what we have today, which is 8. We've expanded. We've grown. We're in a bank building. So, it's like a long hallway. We think of it like a train car. You got the reception area is the engine. Mm-hmm. And then you go all the way to the back and there's the staff lounge. And
can we set up bowling pins and bowling?
You know what? I have done that. I've thrown balls down the hall. You have fun with what you have. It's tight at times. And right now we're in the process of, looking at reconfiguring the space. I've had some architectural drawings done. We're outgrowing it. but we get a lot done in a tight area. We're about 2,500 square feet.
Hey Lou, I want to ask you a question related to your own transition. And I know that, each transition is going to be different, from the senior doc to the new doc. There are definitely listeners to the Thriving Dentist Show, young dentists who are either about to graduate from dental school or recently graduated that are going to come into their dad's practice. Can you offer any tips for that situation? And they're all going to be different, of course, because of the relationship between father and son. But can you share, knowing what you know now, could you share any tips with any of our listeners that might be either going through that transition or about to at some point?
You know, it's a great question, Gary. My biggest piece of advice, and it could be a daughter or a son going in, you really take that opportunity to work on hone your skills of practicing dentistry, you know, whether it's operative, endo, perio. But the other part of it is use that person, your father or mother, whatever the case might be, as a mentor. To the profession and be open to what, you know, has worked for them. And like anything else, you find out what you like, what's worked for them and what you don't like. And if there's things you don't like, you don't have to follow that route. Mm. But obviously if they become successful and grown, there's things you can learn from that. And what I found is, I walked into a very successful office and I was able to take it to another level, because eventually they're going to say, hey, you know what? This is yours. And this, you're making the decisions, you're making the calls. Well, take that time out of school because you're just graduating. It isn't dental school anymore. It's not one or two patients a day. It's, right. All of a sudden you're going, 10, 15, 20, 30 patients maybe at times a day that you got coming through the door. You have to become efficient. And the way you become faster and efficient is by, repetition and organization and systems.
I'm hearing you say that, my words, not yours, but it's almost like you came in on your dad's shoulders.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and that's the advice that, use that opportunity. If you're so fortunate to have the opportunity, and I thank God and count my blessings every day. I'm a very fortunate individual, but use it to your advantage. How many years they've practiced, the profession has grown, as you've seen, Gary, you've been around, a few years. Mm-hmm. Look at the materials that we have now in the last 20, 30 years that we didn't have before, that they've grown through and they've become used to, but they have so much knowledge that they've learned along the way, because the best teacher is actually doing and experiencing it.
You know, it reminds me of a situation I have, and you know, I know you know Matt Roberts, the ceramist out in Idaho, and his brother John Roberts, who's a dentist. So this is a family with some deep dental roots. So Matt Roberts is one of the finest dental ceramists I've ever met, an artist, absolute artist. And his brother John's an amazing dentist. Well, John came into his dad's practice, Dick Roberts, and this was in the mid-90s. And Dick was a really good dentist, and he did everything he could in gold,
Okay. Absolutely.
Now, you have to go back to the time and you know, new dentists listening to this are going to be shaking their head like what?
Still the best restoration out there, man. I still prep gold crowns, gold inlays, gold outlays.
So Dick did everything in the 70s and 80s and early 90s in gold. Well, here's John coming in. And John was a very well-trained cosmetic dentist. Now, gold is a great material, except for one thing. Right?
Exactly.
Which would
be
what?
It's ugly.
Well, it's not natural.
Right. It's not natural. It's ugly. As your patients are going to say, it's ugly.
It's ugly. And so here's John coming into his dad's practice and wanted to do everything in porcelain. You know, no metal, everything done in porcelain. John realized that he was going to need to transition, you know, from his dad. And Dick was very, very, very supportive. John learned how to do some things in gold. And by the way, over time, that became a very, very successful transition. But anyway, thank you for that advice. And if you're listening to this, and if you're a son about to take over your dad's practice, if you're a daughter about to take over your dad's or perhaps your mom's, I have a number of situations now in dental school where we've got female dental students who plan to enter their mother's practice as an associate. So how cool is that?
I think it's great.
Yeah.
It's great to see.
Yeah. Hey, let's talk about some cool things you're excited about. And I want to start by talking about something you do in your practice to help your patients with stress and anxiety. Would you take it from there?
Love to. November of 2009, I am in a hotel in Las Vegas, and a friend who I respect, who actually runs Solace Solutions, the makers of Nucom, said to me, "Hey, I gotta get your opinion about this. Come up to my hotel room." And I was like, "You know, I don't swing that way." And myself
in Vegas, I'm thinking, Vegas, keep it clean, Lou, because we're trying to keep our G rating on this podcast. But go ahead.
So, the CEO of the company's name is Jim Poole. And Jim invited myself, and you'll know this name, Mike Miyasaki, up to his hotel room. And they gave us a short presentation on what Nucom is. It didn't even have a name at that point. And we listened to what it could do. And I'll get into that in a moment.
And I'm sure you had a bit of skepticism in that listening.
Oh, my gosh. When I was being told I'm going to get to relax by listening to a pair of headsets and ingesting some chewables and putting a CES device, which is cranial electrical stimulation, behind my ears and some blackout sunglasses, I was like, okay, I'll try it for your amusement. And so I did. You know, Mike actually disappeared into the bathroom when he said, "Who wants to go first?" So I said, "I will." You know, and you're in Vegas, you had a little bit of a hangover. It was about 10 or 11 in the morning. And about 30 minutes later, you know, you're relaxing in the chair, you know, and somebody's like rubbing my shoulder. I was like, "Oh, I feel really good." Mm-hmm. And I took everything. I was like, "Okay." So Jim's like, "What do you think?" I said, "This is great. My hangover's gone." And not saying it's a cure for hangovers. But anyways, 2 weeks later, Jim came to the office with a Nucom system. And my first patient was about 260 pounds, needing 4 root tips extracted from the maxilla. Very fearful of the dentist. And I told him about Nucom. I said, "Can we set you up on it?" He said, "Sure." So the procedure is very easy. You have him chew on these all-natural tablets. A CES device is put behind the ears. Some headphones are put on to play a binaural beat that relaxes the brain waves down, and some dark sunglasses. So We let him chill out for about 3 to 5 minutes, gave him a topical, gave him his injections, and let that sit. And then I started the procedure to remove the root tips. And, you know, this is a big guy, 6'5", 260. And I got this elevator in my hands, and I'm going after these root tips, and this guy's not budging. And I look down the hall, and Jim's kind of looking at me. And I turned to him, and I was like, oh, my goodness. This is amazing. So from that point forward, we started using NuCom within the practice. And we didn't know what we didn't know at that point in time. And what we have found is what's going on is patients come into the dental office, how are they feeling typically?
Well, by statistics, the majority of them are experiencing some kind of anxiety and, and pain.
Exactly. They're stressed out.
They're stressed.
Right. They walk in, the olfactory nerves take off and, you know, oh, I'm at the dental office. You know, it's fear, it's anxiety, it's stress. And the sympathetic nervous system is kicking in,
right,
in all essence. You're more aware.
And for many patients, it's happening very subconsciously. You know, it's the, you know, that smell of eugenol or whatever it is that, is wafting through the air. You know, it's happening subconsciously, but they're very much feeling tension.
Oh, completely. So what NuCom will do is it will regulate, you know, your system. It'll take that sympathetic system and take it out of the equation in terms of the parasympathetic kicking in and getting the body to relax. And it gets it to relax by using the NuCom system. I'm simplifying this a lot because I know we don't have a lot of time. But the patient becomes calmer, and you have a reduction in gag reflexes. You have a reduction in the mandible and the masseter muscles relaxing. You know, you're not fighting the patient in the chair for control. And you become more efficient. You become more productive because you're becoming less of a counselor at that point in time. And the question becomes, has this impacted any relationships I've had with my patient? Absolutely not. They appreciate it, and they actually ask for it when they come in. When patients are stressed out, they cannot make, you know, proper decision-making, proper judgment. You know, and if they're stressed out before the visit, their ability to sleep is impinged upon.
Right.
So now they even have more anxiety when they come into the dental chair. So let's
take as I know there's listeners that will be very interested in this. There's four elements, as I understand, to NuCom. Can we break those down? So it starts with they chew an ingestible. So let's go through the four different elements and just hit on some of the science behind it, if you would.
Okay. So the four elements are, I'll start out with. The first is these chewable tablets, and there's also a cream that's available as well. Mm-hmm. They contain GABA, which is gamma-aminobutyric acid. It's a natural substance already occurring in your body that helps produce relaxation. It helps reduce stress.
Mm-hmm.
The other is L-theanine. L-theanine is found in things as green tea.
Right.
Cottage cheese, big Thanksgiving dinner. So again, mm-hmm. all natural substance. The CES device, which is the next component here of the four, the CES device has been around for about 45, 50 years.
And again, review the acronym again.
CES, cranial electrical stimulation.
Okay.
And it's been shown to reduce again, stress, help you relax. What it does is it helps the uptake of the GABA and the L-theanine into your system. Then I know this all, and when I heard this the first time, I was like, what? This can't really work. You know, you're full of it. The next part of this is a pair of blockout sunglasses,
mm-hmm.
or a mask that goes over your eyes. Now, it's been proven, the science has shown that by reducing visual stimulation, there was a reduction of 35, it reduces 35% of your stress. When you don't see something coming at you.
Right.
Okay. It's like, okay, like somebody's pointing a gun at you. Well, if you had a mask on, you wouldn't know.
Right.
Or if a shark's coming at you and you couldn't see, you wouldn't know.
Right.
So visual stimulation is reduced automatically 30, 35%. And then in the headset, you would be listening to classical music. Okay. But what's hidden in that music is what's called a binaural beat. And this binaural beat brings the brain waves down to a alpha wavelength. That alpha wavelength is like a pre-sleep state. You know when you're going to sleep at night and your head's just relaxing and that some of the thoughts of the day are going through, but you haven't fallen asleep, because that's a deeper sleep. You're not going to get into a deep sleep with NuCom.
Right.
So the combination of all these four bring you down to this alpha wavelength. And it's kind of up and down in this pattern, hence the binaural beat.
And yet the patient is, correct me if I'm wrong on this, Lou, but the patient is conscious. So they're responding to your direction, correct?
Correct.
So you need them to open wider, or you need them to turn right, turn left. They're fully responsive.
They're fully responsive.
But just relax. They're in just a relaxed state of responsiveness.
Exactly. You need them to open, they can open more. You need to turn their head, they can turn their head.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so cool. You tell them to stay open, maybe you had to go do a hygiene check. You come back, they're still in the same open position.
Nice.
It's wild. It's so nice.
Now, do you charge for the service?
I do not charge for the service. Okay. I do not charge for it. I include it. I let them know what it would be if we, you know, if there was a charge.
So that's nice.
By
the way, that's a great
practice builder.
That's a great idea, to, you know, let them know that, you know, a normal charge for this would be such and such. However, we have decided to make it available to our patients as a value added service. There's a great tip right there.
Hands down. It's a great feature of it. And how it's grown is, you know, this is being used on 5 continents right now. So it's become viral itself. It's being picked up all around the world in terms of its use. But what's really cool within the practice, Gary, is patients come in asking for it now.
Yeah. I mean, imagine the buzz around people going, let's say they leave your office and they go back to work. And you know, many of their coworkers knew they were at the dentist, and they're going to ask, how was your visit? And imagine the conversations that happened. And I bet your reviews reflect that. I bet you're seeing some Google reviews and Yelp reviews and online reviews that are reflecting their satisfaction.
You do. You do see it. You know, patients are very satisfied, happy. You know, I've had Facebook postings. You know, I think we've had some Yelp, like you said, and the Google Plus. And that's all practice building. You know, because word of mouth referrals and social reviews, I mean, that's the best advertising you can get to get patients into the practice. Now, let's take it a step further. Dentistry is a profession, we know, as a practitioner, as an office worker, a team member, is very stressful. So a benefit in my practice is all my team knows that they can use the NuCom anytime they want. Myself, I NuCom 2 to 3 times a week. This morning I got into the office, we were chatting a little earlier, and it was about 6:30. I got to the practice and I opened up all the windows. So we have beautiful weather here in Chicago today.
And unlike 2 weeks ago.
Unlike 2 weeks ago. And nice breeze coming through the office. And I was like, you know what? I didn't have a great night's sleep last night. Just had some things on my mind, blah, blah, blah. I NuCom for about 30 minutes. I had an awesome day, because you become very focused.
Mm-hmm.
What we've discovered over the years, the company has discovered, and I don't get any money, whether, you know, from them for talking about this, is you become more focused. You're more alert, but you get restorative sleep. That's the key.
Mm-hmm.
Athletes are using it. Chicago Blackhawks.
I was going to say, Chicago Blackhawks trainer I know is using this post-game, and they're using that to recoup their athletes, to recover.
Isn't that cool?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that?
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just, And they're not the only sports team. There's other teams out there.
Apparently, you know who
Tony Robbins is, right? Don't you?
Of course.
You know, okay.
Apparently, this hasn't been introduced to the Cubs yet.
Yeah. No, well, hey, this is our year, man. This is our year. Cubs are going to do it.
You can say that in March, and I'm jumping on the bandwagon with you. I think this is going to be your year, Lou.
I think we got it this time, man.
I really do.
So I recommend, you know, the team doing it, you do it as the doctor, because you do feel better. Mm-hmm. Your mind performs at a better level, because what we are so inundated by, what the cell phone, the computer.
We're overstimulated.
We are such an overstimulated. I know you're a big, you know, workout. You run every day. Myself, you know, I got into cycling 2.5 years ago, and just to get rid of the stress and anxiety, I go to the gym as much as I can as well. But you need that meditative time.
Yeah, you do.
And they have done heart rate studies on this. Check this out. NuCom has been able to get patients' heart rates down almost to the point where the yogi masters are at.
Wow.
Is that wild?
That is crazy. How cool is that? Well, so, you know what? I'm going to put their website in the show notes, because I know our listeners will want to check it out. Much investment involved in putting
that
it
one
in,
more time?
Is there much of an investment involved in putting it in your practice?
There is a little bit of an investment, but I'm sure they have plans for people who are interested in adopting. I can't speak to that. Yeah. That's a call for
We'll direct our listeners to their website. I'll put the NuCom website in the show notes so you can get more information about that. But I'll tell you what, I'm making notes. If you heard my pen moving across the paper, I was making notes because we do a fair amount of oral conscious sedation dentistry using triazolam. Mm-hmm. And then on occasion we can bring in a dental anesthesiologist and do IV sedation. We'd prefer not to because of the complications of IV sedation, but this sounds like a really nice addition to any practice. And, this is the kind of thing patients are going to be thrilled with, I'm sure.
I agree 100%. You know, it's great to have an armamentarium, to your practice.
Mm-hmm. Love it. Hey, let's use this as a bridge to talk about the next subject. A hot topic today is how dentists, especially solo dentists, can remain independent in the face of corporate dentistry and the rise in corporate dentistry. And I know you've got some strong feelings about that and some solutions about that. But would you agree that this is a hot topic today in dentistry?
Oh, yeah. It's definitely a hot topic, Gary. There's a real fear of corporate dentistry taking over, mainstream independent sole practitioners or small group practices or the small group practice model. Mm-hmm. And it all goes down to the fact that it's economics. It's purchasing power that corporate dental offices have because they amass large quantities of practices and they can purchase goods at a lower cost. Mm-hmm. And it becomes line items to them, and there's ways for us to fight that as a profession. Now, I'm not saying there's corporate dentistry is a bad thing. There's some really good corporate dental companies out there, if you will, who are, I mean, I like to say, very ethical. Mm-hmm. But you're within the industry. I do have contact with a lot of members of the profession these days, and I hear good stories and I hear bad stories.
Sure.
But I think the beauty of the dental profession is you truly can be an entrepreneur. You truly can, build a practice of your dreams. You can create the schedule that you want. It's up to you. And there's a lot to be said to being an independent business owner.
Hey, I'm drinking the Kool-Aid. And I completely agree. I think owning your own practice is the best route. And I'm bullish on independent practice. I'm absolutely bullish on it. However, it would be a mistake to stick our heads in the sand and pretend that there aren't some changes, going on out there. Lou, what are you doing to remain independent?
Great question. What we are doing is I recently, a few months ago, after some research, was asked to join Smile Source. And Smile Source is a company that just, it affords you different verticals within the vertical of dentistry. And I would say camaraderie, education, study clubs, or studying together. But it also affords you the ability of having purchasing power. And what I mean by that is there's agreements with vendors, if you will, to buy the same products that you do at a more affordable, beneficial costs.
I'm not going to go into all the details of it. But the reasons of that are simple, though. You're when you're buying as a Smile Source member, you're buying, you know, with the power of hundreds of practices behind you instead of lose solo practice.
That's the key, Gary. You're straight on with that. We're all buying together. You know, if we're all going to BioHorizons to buy our implants, you know, great. BioHorizons is going to cut you a better deal.
Right. In fact, I'm going to see you next week in San Antonio.
I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, I missed you in Chicago, but we got to get together in a neutral third site, third location out there in San Antonio. I'm speaking one of the days at the SmileSource, what they call their exchange meeting. And I'll be there and you'll be there next week. We had Lance Timmerman on recently, and Lance talked about some of the benefits he was experiencing in his practice in Seattle as being a Smile Source member. And I've recently reached out to Trevor Maurer, and we've got Trevor coming on. Trevor is the CEO of Smile Source.
Oh, beautiful. Great guy.
Yeah, we've got Trevor.
You are going to have a great podcast with him.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. Trevor has become a good friend, and I've reached out to him, and we're going to talk about some of the changing dynamics in dentistry. And I'm pretty excited about some of the things that SmileSource is doing. I'll put SmileSource, put their website in the show notes. So if you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel. I'll put their website. I encourage you to go back and click on that and learn more about SmileSource. Hey, I want to switch gears because this relates to it as well, the discussion of remaining independent. And I want to talk about two topics that I'm going to blend in together, Lou. They could be handled separately, but I think they commingle together. And one of those is the idea of planting aesthetic seeds. In other words, planting seeds in your patient's mind about the wonderful things we could do to help them have their ideal smile. Recently, I had Guy Lewis on. I know you know Guy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
You know, Guy was one of the original founders of AACD. In fact, we're going to see Guy next Wednesday night at the ZZ Top concert. The ZZ Top band are patients of Guy Lewis, and so he's going to take care of us next Wednesday night for that concert. But anyway, I want to talk about planting aesthetic seeds, and related to that, I also want to talk about the idea of comprehensive treatment planning. And, you know, while comprehensive treatment plan does not necessarily have to be aesthetic related, it could be more functionally related. I believe those two topics kind of commingle. Help our listeners understand a little bit more about the benefits of planting seeds and why we have an obligation to do comprehensive treatment planning for our patients.
Great topic. Comprehensive treatment planning is, you know, it's really goes back. It goes back to dental school. It's the foundation of being a practitioner of dentistry, and providing our patients with, you know, doing the complete oral exam, and that means, you know, the entire existing conditions the patient walks into your office as a new patient. If they're an existing patient of a practice you might be acquiring, is, you know, gathering that information. Because what that does, it tells the patient at a point in time what their health is and what can be done to correct it. It allows you to make the correct diagnoses by saying to patients, you know, you do have fractures in some of these molars or your bicuspids. Mm-hmm. You do have periodontal disease. And myself and my associates, any new patient coming in, any patient coming in through hygiene that might not have been in for a while, they will be either that day have a comprehensive exam or be brought back. New patients coming in all have a comprehensive exam. That means making sure all radiographs are completely up to date. All charting is done. And it includes the perio as well. If diagnostic casts have to be done, they're taken. Intraoral photos, those are taken. And then we're able to gather this information and then say to the patient, this is the condition of your mouth today. This is what we can do for you. Now that becomes planting the seed. And, if it's a patient who's interested in, recreating their smile, this is what can be done to recreate your smile. And it's not just doing a patch job on one tooth.
Right.
I want your smile to outlive you. I want these restorations to outlive you. And they appreciate it.
And yet, let me share a challenge, Lou. This came up. I was speaking recently, giving a course recently, and I want to share a story with you and with our listeners. A dentist came up to me at the break, and he had been out of dental school for 10 years now, so he'd been in practice for 10 years. And he said, Gary, he said, one of the challenges that I have, he said, I never know when I should be comprehensive with a patient and present everything, that I see, or whether I should just go with the phase treatment because I'm afraid of blowing them out of the water. That was his term, not mine. So do you understand that did I frame that question in your mind, Lou, as what he was asking me? He said, I don't know. And this is probably a dentist that maybe had been snake bit, had presented comprehensive dentistry to patients in the past and then had them just disappear. Because he blew him out of the water. But
you have to be really, really careful with that.
Yeah.
Because you could turn him off and be running for the door.
Mm-hmm.
And my suggestion is, you could have patients coming in, for an aesthetic case, or in hygiene that you see, and you can begin discussions of, maybe it's veneers or luminaires, minimally invasive veneers.
Right.
But we have an obligation and a duty to report our findings to the patient. And I believe it all gets back to communication from what you see. And I think, I think there's nothing wrong with staging treatment. And there's different levels of, if it's a full blown restorative case, comprehensive rebuilding case, from a simple, a couple crowns need to be taken care of, or you need a root canal, a post and a crown. It's different from patient to patient, but you don't want to overwhelm them because that's just, they could just think you're in there for a sales deal, but you can, excuse me, it's better to identify with them, this is what's happening in your mouth today. This is what we need to do to get you healthy. And I appreciate you have a dental budget and it's going to take some time to get you where you need to be. And there's other places in the country where, you can blow them out of the way, out of the water, and they say, fine. We can never assume. Somebody always says, you never assume what a patient has in their pocket.
It's so true. So true.
You just can't do it. I don't know if I used this analogy last time with you, but, I used to like to fish all the time. We used to go up to Canada and you could go casting 1,000 times and waiting for a bite, for a muskie to hit or, a big fish. And you don't know when it's going to happen. You don't know when it's going to hit.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, sorry about that. Sorry about that noise.
No worries.
Okay. Phone call coming in on the Mac computer. It's like, whoa, what's happening? But you keep throwing it out there because you don't know when you're going to get the hit.
Yeah.
But if you don't get the hit today, it doesn't mean no today. It just means no right now. Right.
Can I share?
True story. I am fortunate enough to have a wonderful woman in my life now, and when I asked her out, she tried fixing me up with other girls. And I said to her, I said, you know what? I said, I want to go out with you. I don't want to go out.
But I have friend. But I have a friend.
So long story short is I wound up going out with the girlfriend. But the night before I was supposed to go out with the girlfriend, I ran into this woman. And she said, when's your date? And I said, well, my date's tomorrow night, but I still want to go out with you. And before I knew it, she was laying a big kiss on me. But you know what did I? Yeah, you got to take chance. You got to swing. You got to swing. You want to get on base, swing the bat.
Well, it's that Wayne Gretzky, famous Wayne Gretzky quote: "You miss every shot you don't take. Miss every shot." Luke, can I share a technique, if you will, on how you might frame a discussion with a patient about comprehensive care? May I share that with you?
Absolutely. Please.
So I'd learned this, and I want to emphasize that there is no one size fits all. There's not one magic phrase to use or, you know, anything like that. But I want you to listen to this, Lou, and critique it for me if you would, because I learned this many years ago from Dr. Bob Marr. Bob was one of our instructors at PAC Live, and he just had a very genuine way of communicating with patients. And Lou, can I use you as an example, and I'll role play as say Dr. Nielsen?
Sure.
So you're in the chair, and clearly I can tell that you have a lot of needs, dentally in your mouth. So I'm going to start by saying something like this. Hey Lou, I've had a chance to look at the records, look at the x-rays that we took and look at the photos that we took. And I've had a chance to, understand from you what's important to you. And in a minute, I'm going to share some recommendations with you. But before I do that, I want to share with you kind of our approach here. Would it be okay if I did that?
Absolutely.
So please. Our approach, Lou, is the way I look at it is it's my job as the dentist to identify any areas of concern in your mouth and then make recommendations that'll get you as healthy as possible. And it's your job as the patient to decide what, if anything, you'd like to do about it. Does that sound fair?
Sounds very fair to me.
Now, notice, and again, this is not meant to be a script. This is not meant to be anything mechanical. But notice, and the first time I heard Bob say that many years ago in his practice in Palm Desert, I said, wow, that's amazing. And he looked at me like, what? And I said, no, just how you were communicating. He goes, what did I say? I mean,
it was so natural.
And he said, that's just how I look at it. He says, I look at it. It's my job as the dentist to identify any areas of concern in your mouth and then make recommendations that'll get you as healthy as possible. And it's your job to decide what, if anything, you'd like to do about it.
I love the verbiage. And, you know, I'm thinking of patients I've talked to over the years in success. And I don't use those exact words, but it's pretty much the story I tell them. I put it back on the patient. You know, it's our job to inform and diagnose, but it's their job to say, I guess, yay or nay.
And the truth is that, and we don't like to think of it this way, Lou, because of everything we know, but they don't, unless we're talking about, you know, pain, inflammation, and swelling, they don't have to do anything.
Right.
In fact, they don't have to have their teeth. I mean, we don't like to think about it that way, but isn't that the gosh honest truth?
Hands down, they don't.
They don't have to. It's not necessary. I mean, it's not, it's certainly not a path to health. We know that. But ultimately, they it's their choice. But Bob would say, you know, and then it's your job to decide what, if anything, you'd like to do about it.
I love that.
Does that sound fair? And everybody, and I heard him say this in some variation, in some way, shape, or form, hundreds of times. And every time he said, that sounds really fair, doc. And then he'd share some recommendations. And before he would, ask them what like they do, he said, please know we can go as slow or as fast as you like. We could get you healthy right away, or we could phase it in over time if that's important to you. And I heard another
great
way.
Great verbiage.
You and I have a mentor, Dr. Reed, Omer Reed. Omer had a slightly different approach at this. Before he presented any recommendations, he'd say this. Can we go back into role playing for just a minute?
Yeah, go for it.
And let's full disclosure. We did not discuss this ahead of time, correct? We did not discuss this exercise I'm about to do. Okay. So, Omer would say, you know, I've had a chance to look at the records. We took some photos, we took some records, and I had a chance to look at those. And Lou, I've had a chance to kind of get to know what's important to you, and I want to make some recommendations for you. But before I do that, may I ask you a couple questions?
Yes, please go ahead.
They're simple, but they're important.
Okay.
Lou, how healthy would you like to be?
Very healthy, extremely healthy.
By the way, did you know, let's come off of role-playing for a minute. Did you notice my pregnant pause? It's hard to stop after saying the simple question, how healthy would you like to be?
Yes, it's very hard to. You have to force yourself.
You want to keep going because you know. Yeah. Blah, 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 yeah. But he would just say, look the patient right in the eyes and say, Lou, how healthy would you like to be?
I think it's great because you know what about communication? What is it? You need to listen.
My grandmother said, the good Lord gave you two ears and one mouth for a reason. You should listen more than you talk. And guess what almost every patient said when you said, how healthy would you like to be? That's a trick question. And I mean it in a friendly way. That's not meant to be manipulative, but that's a trick question because there's only one answer to that.
There's only one answer.
All the way, doc. I want to be healthy. And then he'd pause and he'd say, by when?
But it's so great, though. Mm. I mean, what a great statement.
Yeah, how healthy would you like to be? They don't say, well, a little bit, just a little bit healthier. They say they want to be healthy. And then he'd pause, and so let's go back to the role playing. So you said you want to be healthy, right?
I want to be healthy, yeah, extremely.
Let me ask a second question, Lou. By when? And notice the pregnant pause.
Exactly. As soon as possible. Exactly. Role play, but I'm going to say as soon as possible.
But by the way, guess what most people say? Right away as soon. And sometimes they'd say, as soon as possible, if I can afford it. Right. That's a fair answer, right?
They will. They'll say, can I afford it? How am I going to pay for it?
Yeah.
When can we get started?
But I love either one of those. And again, it's not meant to be a one size fits all where you just, have a trick phrase that you use, but you can use that first approach, of saying it's my role as a dentist to identify any areas of concern and then make recommendations that'll get you as healthy as possible. And then, does that sound fair to you? It's your job as a patient to decide what, if anything, you want to do about it. And that's a great way. And then, for selected patients, you might try Omer's approach of just asking. I have two simple questions. Before I make recommendations, Lou, I've got two questions I'd like to ask you. Is that all right? Sure. Number one, how healthy would you like to be?
It's perfect. It's perfect. It's great verbiage.
Then the other approach I wanted to share, with our listeners and with you, Lou, I know you do this as well. I've heard you do this. But I think an analogies work very well. With patients. They don't understand the technical aspects of what you're going to do for them, but they can understand a story. And one of the things that Paul uses a lot in our practice, his wife's name is Erin. And if he had a female patient in the chair, he might say something like this. He might say, Linda, if my wife Erin was in my dental chair and she had the same condition that you have in your mouth, this is what I'd do for Erin. I'd like to do the same thing for you.
That works great.
And I've heard you do that. That's why I wanted to have you comment on that.
I always tell patients, I'm not going to refer you to somebody I would not refer my family member to. I would not recommend treatment to you that I would not recommend for my own family or my own son, my own daughter, my mother, my father. I've used all those analogies. I've had family members who've requested, different procedures that I offer in the practice. And patients, they see that. It's genuine. You're talking from the heart.
They get it. You're being real. They may not understand osseointegration of the implant. They may not understand that.
They're not going to get that.
But they're going to understand that if my wife was in the chair, if my mother was in the chair, and she had that missing tooth there, this is what I'd do for her. I'd like to do the same thing for you.
Yeah, they might ask you how you get along with your wife.
That's true. Well, you maybe don't. But, you maybe don't want to use the mother-in-law example. But that may not be. But Jen, you know, that works. That works really well.
Extremely well. But don't you think, Gary? I mean, that's just all about, you know, relating to another human being.
Yeah.
Telling the story.
It is.
You know, and showing compassion and care for them.
Well, it reminds me of another
connecting.
It reminds me of another quote that Omer shared with me, and I always give him attribution to this quote, although he would tell you he heard it from somewhere else. But it's the patient doesn't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And I know that everything you do in your practice is built around that approach. I suspect that everything your father did in his practice was built around that approach. And it's timeless, isn't it?
It is timeless. It really is. I mean, you have to show the care and concern.
Yeah. Hey, as we're coming into the finish line here, can I put you on the spot for just a second?
Yeah, absolutely.
So we have a lot of young dentists that are listening to the show. You now have 21 years in practice. Give a couple of quick pieces of advice for a young dentist just launching their career. Knowing what you know now, what would you do if you were right out of dental school right now?
Right out of dental school right now.
What would you do?
What would I do? I would, you know, look at the year ahead and decide what continuing education courses I want to attend. And pick two or three of interest to you, because continuing education is just so important for all of us. And, you know, it's great to listen to webinars. And it's great to, you know, do it virtually. Mm-hmm. But I think it is more important to go to a classroom or a venue and be able to listen to a lecturer or a speaker on a subject and interact with our peers, because we have become, you don't want to just practice in a cave. You need the exposure to your peers in your profession. Get involved in study clubs. Find a mentor. Those are some of the biggest things. You don't ever want to feel like you're practicing alone.
You know, I love that. And again, we didn't talk about this ahead of time, so I didn't know what you were going to say. But I love this direction, though, Lou, because I know you are where you are today, at least in part because of the massive commitment you've made to your continuing education. You take, hundreds of hours.
Yeah.
It's thousands now, but hundreds of hours. You know, Paul takes about 200 hours a year of CE.
You know, you don't feel like it's enough.
Yeah.
That's the thing. You never feel like it's enough.
But it also keeps dentistry really exciting. We were talking to Guy Lewis, on the show recently, and here Guy is 31 years, in, and he said he gets excited about going out and taking courses. It makes dentistry really fun, you know, today after 31 years.
It does. It does make it much more exciting. You know, it really does. Learning new techniques.
And, you know, there's a lot of young dentists that feel like they're in a catch-22 of saying, yes, I hear this, but I can't afford it. And I would ask you to frame it a little bit differently. And I'd ask you to frame it, you know, certainly there's ways that you can stretch your continuing education budget. Gordon Christensen, for example, offers a 50% discount to dentists that are 5 years or less out of dental school. There's great ways that you can get involved in a local AGD study club and get a great value of, you know, CE. And, you know, there's great ways to stretch the budget. But with that aside, I would ask you to frame it differently in your mind and think of it as the best investment you could possibly make. You're investing in yourself.
It's the best investment. You'll get it back 100-fold. Yeah.
Hey, Lou, I want to thank you. You had a busy day today, and you're kind enough to jump on the interview tonight. Thanks so much. Thanks for all that you do. If you ever get a chance to hear Lou lecture, I want you to run, don't walk. To that course. Lou, you're pretty active out there on the lecture circuit. And if he's anywhere near you, make a plan to come out and join him. He's a dentist that's doing some very, very cool things. Lou, I know that our listeners would like to reach out to you. Would it be all right if I provided your email address?
Please do. Thank you so much for having me on this podcast, the show. It's really a pleasure, Gary. I love talking to you. You're fun. You're knowledgeable. You're enjoyable. And share my information. Oh, thank you.
Let me just double check, make sure I have it. I've got Lou Kauf, LOUKAUF @gmail.com. Do I have the right email address?
That's it, man.
Perfect. Hey, and I want to invite our listeners, reach out to Lou. I'll make sure I put the email address in the show notes, but reach out and just introduce yourself. And by the way, if you have never been to the fantastic city of Chicago, you now have a friend in Chicago.
Darn straight.
Now, last time I checked, there are some pretty decent restaurants in Chicago.
Oh man, there's so many good restaurants in Chicago.
That's the understatement of the year, by the way. But if you're listening to this, and we have listeners in 144 countries, but if you're listening to this, write Lou an email and just say thanks. You can just make it a one word email and just write thank you in there. I know Lou will appreciate hearing from you. But you now have a friend in Chicago, and I'll take the liberty of encouraging them to reach out to you, because I know you'll be happy to show them your great city and get a chance to say they have a friend in Chicago, huh?
Absolutely, Gary. I mean, my pleasure. To show them around, to show my office, whatever it takes.
Hey, awesome.
You're
doing cool things. You're doing some really cool things with minimally invasive veneers, with CBCT, with really cool things with, comprehensive treatment planning, comprehensive diagnosis, a bunch of aesthetic dentistry. And yet you're an everyday dentist, just like all of our listeners. I use that term in the most complimentary way. When I say you're an everyday dentist, you are very much, a family general practice that also has the capability of providing your patients gorgeous smiles and doing very complex restorative dentistry, if that's indicated. So Lou's a great role model of what it means to be successful in 2016 and beyond. So again, thanks, Lou. And let me take a minute and thank our listeners. Thanks so much for listening to the Thriving Dentist Show. We sure appreciate you. There's three ways you can support our show. Number one, tell one of your colleagues about it. There's a lot of dentists that have never heard of they don't know the word podcast. So you might have to show them your phone and show them how to download a podcast. Secondly, you can write a review on iTunes. Let me invite you to do that. If you write a review on iTunes, it'll help more dentists be able to find us. And third, if you don't already subscribe, hit the subscribe button to whatever you're listening. If you listen on iTunes, you can hit that subscribe button on iTunes. If you listen on Google Play or Stitcher Radio, you can hit subscribe there. If you subscribe, that means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically uploaded to your listening device and you'll never miss a show. On that note, let me simply say thank you. Lou, I'll look forward to seeing you next week in San Antonio. We're going to have a great time.
Oh, so looking forward to it.
I think I'll see you Wednesday night at the ZZ Top concert first.
I will be there. I will definitely be there.
Well, listen, thank you guys. I'll look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.